Welcome, dear participants, to the second module of the fourth week of this course. Today, we are going to take up a study of different types of feminist strains of thought. As we have discussed earlier, there is an inbuilt plurality in the way feminist thought has developed because it is not a proactive argument. And therefore, in response to various developments in the society, the development of various schools of thought, it has also responded to these needs and come up with similar arguments for gender equality. And therefore, for today's discussion, I have taken up these different strains of feminist thoughts for some discussion. They are liberal, Marxist, socialist, radical, cultural, black, and ecofeminism. Before we take up these different schools, once again I would say that even though all these schools have a diversity as far as their approach towards equality achievement goal is concerned, still we would find that basically all of them aim for getting an equal treatment for women in every sphere of life. And therefore, diversity of approach should never be treated as an obstacle. Liberal feminism, as the title itself suggests, has been deeply influenced by the liberal movements of the early 20th century of political thought. At the same time, it also has an impact of the philosophy of Harold J. Lasky. They say that gender prejudice is based on individual ignorance, and therefore, education is a very important tool to fight against gender-based discrimination. They also suggest that the educational policies and the legal framework of the societies should become different in order to accommodate the demands of equality for women. Another aspect which the liberal feminist brought to foreground of the discussion was that women may have legal equality in different countries and societies, but at the same time, it is not possible for them to have status related equality, and they think that in order to sensitize people towards the status related equality of women, one has to basically bank on education and gradual awareness of the people. They also suggest that revolutionary and sudden changes would not be very effective. The critics of liberal feminist school often say that this is a very conservative way of looking at things, and they also say that this is a feminist approach of white middle class women particularly, because there is a lot of emphasis on education, self-awareness, training, which may not exactly result into tangible changes. Marxist feminism, as the name itself suggests, is a response to the Marxist philosophy. In many ways, we find that the Marxist feminists were able to put across demands which are very pertinent even today. Marxist feminists also believe that the exploitation of women is rooted in capitalist class relationships, and that men are conditioned to have exploitative relationships at work in order to propagate the capitalist class exploitation. However, this conditioning is carried by them towards home and women, and therefore, they view patriarchy as an ideology which stems from the attempts of men to justify exploitation of women for economic gains and for the consolidation of the economic gains by the people. Another aspect which is very important in Marxist philosophy is that they feel that the family system itself is a product of patriarchy and capitalism for the exploitation of women. They also feel that capitalism and patriarchy have continued the family system. They established it and continued it because of several reasons. Firstly, within a family, a woman can be reduced to the position of an unpaid domestic worker, and all the household chores which are time taking, which continue for a very long time. For example, all the roles related with rearing of the children, with the caring of the aged people, taking care of the infirm, etc. At the same time, Marxist philosophy believes that the origin of family is linked with the desire that only the legitimate sons should inherit the money, the title, and the land which has been gained by a man. So basically, the Marxist philosophers, the Marxist feminist philosophers believe that feminism is a response to these situations where a woman has been exploited by this conjoining together of patriarchy and capitalist attitude. So women become domestic servants, dignified though, and then these roles are glorified so that they can continue peacefully in these roles. However, a particular aspect of Marxist feminism which brings it very close to post-feminist school of thought is that it does not view men necessarily as enemy of women. They feel that men and women have to work together as a team. They have to cooperate to overthrow the capitalist system of economic exploitation. For them, more than the patriarchy, it is the concept of social class which is important. And they feel that patriarchy is a product of class struggle. It is a design of the capitalist class. They also feel, and again you would find that this brings them slightly closer to the postmodernist thinking of diversity, that they emphasize that women are not a sex class and that the only thing which women have common is their biological constitution. They also suggest that upper class women would not necessarily have anything in common with a woman belonging to a working class. The Marxist feminist school is very close to the socialist feminism, but the differences are also there. For example, in Marxist feminist philosophy, the struggle is necessarily violent and brutal, and then it is also sustained by the experiences of Soviet Russia, where the Russian Revolution had necessarily been brutal, oppressive and violent for different segments of the society. They also feel that the roles which are traditionally given to women, for example, rearing up of the child, that taking care of the infirm, etc., should be taken over by the state, and the state in their opinion is not a democratic state but the dictatorship of the proletariat. So we find that the Marxist feminist philosophy has developed in tandem with the Marxist emphasis on the violent struggle and that annihilation of the capitalist class and the establishment of the dictatorship of the proletariat. So, a struggle of women for them is necessarily a part of the class struggle. Socialist feminism, in fact, incorporates some of the demands of the Marxist philosophy and joins them together with radical feminism and the idea of cultural conditioning. They also feel that the main reason for the exploitation of women is their economic dependence on their male partners. And they also feel that their work and social status is highly marginalized by their potential and actual dual role in modern societies. Earlier, women were given the household responsibilities, rearing of the children, etc. But even in today's society, we find that the duality of roles has necessarily become their compulsion. So we find that the employees are able to exploit this dual role to pay women less, and in modern day terminology, we can understand it as a genesis of the glass ceiling, where beyond a certain level, women are not encouraged to grow. For example, today we can question the number of the women who are a member of the boards in different institutions and organizations. The socialist feminist school also believe that the partners also exploit women by receiving unpaid services within the framework of home and family. And therefore, the exploitation of women is related with their domestic roles. They feel that patriarchal power is consolidated by a general misogyny, which we have discussed previously also, by citing the examples of Aristotle and Saint Aquinas, etc., a cultural bias that women are passive and therefore they are unable to think in a very coherent fashion, and pseudo-scientific studies which continue from medieval times till today, which tell us that women, because of the fact of simply being women, are better suited to a particular type of chore and vice versa. Educational studies justifying biases and confirming stereotypes, and these ideas force women to believe that the traditional role of a mother or a housewife or a wife are their basic roles and they should never be violated, whatever else they may try to do in their life. Radical feminism is basically rooted in the 1960s. As we have seen earlier in our discussion, the decade of the 1960s was a decade of vehement protest. Radical feminism, which became popular in and around 1960s, is also a reflection of this attitude. It is rooted in a Latin root, radix or radic, which is used as an adjective meaning of or pertaining to the root or going to the root. So, radical feminism is a movement which believes that sexism is so deeply rooted in our society that the only cure is to eliminate the concept of gender altogether. They believe that the concepts of patriarchy and sex class are key ideas in relation to the understanding of women's position and experiences in all societies, and that patriarchy has existed in all known societies and predates capitalist forms of economic and gender exploitation. So, whereas Marxist philosophers believe that capitalism had come earlier and capitalism started patriarchal tendencies, radical feminists believe that patriarchy had existed earlier and has predated capitalist forms of economic consolidation. They also see that sexual inequality is institutionalized in society and it cannot be finished by legal means or simply by educating people or coercing people or encouraging them to change their attitudes. And therefore, they believe in sudden and radical ways to overthrow the grasp of the patriarchy over women. They believe that men are necessarily the oppressors and therefore, they should be treated as enemies by women. In fact, today when often people equate the word feminism with feminazi, often they root their arguments in their criticism of radical feminism. So, radical feminists believe that women as a class are together, they are combined together in their interest and therefore, they want collectively to be free of male oppression. They believe that patriarchy exploits female biology, a prolonged incapacity of women during pregnancy for example. They also criticize the institution of marriage because within this marriage system, men normally control the behavior of women. They also believe that heterosexual relationships which are based on sexual binaries go against the interest of women. They have also suggested various solutions. For example, they have advocated support groups of women. Another important aspect about radical feminists is that they are staunch supporters of technology and they feel that women can get their liberation only through the intervention of technology. Not only in terms of time and effort saving devices, but also to enable them to opt for motherhood without going into necessary relationships with men or living within the institutions of family. So, they want that technology should be encouraged further for the emancipation of women. At the same time, they do not necessarily support heterosexuality, and this aspect also comes closer to contemporary gender philosophy. However, because of its radical temperament, radical feminism also came into a lot of criticism and it led to cultural feminism in the next decade. So, whereas we find that the decade of 1960s represents a vehement attitude in the feminist philosophy, in the 70s we find that it is more placid, more laid back and it has been termed as cultural feminism. So, it has developed from radical philosophy of the feminist, although they hold many opposing viewpoints. So, as radical feminism died out as a movement, we find that the cultural feminism started. It is a more peaceful, more laid back way of looking at women's question after the radical demands of the 1960s. It is interestingly a feminist theory of difference that praises the positive aspects of women and it believes in encouraging feminine behavior rather than the masculine. They believe interestingly that women are kinder and gentler than men and therefore, they promote this idea that if a woman culture, the culture of being kind and gentle can also be introduced into a male dominated world, the world would perhaps be a better place, it would be less violent and would have fewer wars. They have this ideology that there is a basic feminine essence, which according to them is kinder and gentler than the essence of men, and therefore they attempt to revalidate what cultural feminists consider undervalued female attributes. It is also a theory that commends the difference of women from men. Now, I have tried to say that often the cultural feminism, the term itself, can be treated as a pejorative term, because many critics of cultural feminism believe that this particular way of thinking enabled the society to focus on those aspects of women's demands which were not exactly working for their equality in every way. And rather than becoming a movement in activism, it ultimately became a lifestyle choice. The term was used for the first time by Alice Ecole, a feminist historian and cultural theorist, and she has credited Red Stockings member Brooke Williams for introducing the term cultural feminism in 1975. However, this term became fashionable only with Linda Atcroft's argument in her article Cultural Feminism versus Post-Structuralism, the Identity Crisis in Feminist Theory. So it was this use by Linda Elkoff which led to the widespread adoption of the term to describe contemporary feminists, and it isolated them from their historical antecedents. So cultural feminism is a response to radical feminism, and it also describes the depoliticization of radical feminism. It is based on an essentialist view of the difference between women and men, and advocates independence and institution building. However, as I have said earlier, it has led feminists to retreat from politics to lifestyle. Various studies have showed that wherever cultural feminists have become strong, the focus has been on lifestyle changes than on actively demanding participation of women in every field. Even though we find that they are rather mixed up in their approach towards things. For example, they hold a very idealistic view with a greater emphasis on sex roles, seeing sexism as being rooted in the contemporary patterns of male and female behavior. They also emphasize that institutions like marriage, family, prostitution, and also heterosexuality exist on perpetuating the sex role system, which can be harmful for the equality demands of women. They also demanded basic human rights for women, such as the freedom for the reproduction, childbirth, freedom for aborting a child, sterilization or birth control. However, they wanted that these choices should be made without any pressure from individual men, doctors, government or religious authorities, and that these choices should be ultimately asserted by women. However, the phrase essential difference becomes a fuzzy zone, and this also becomes the reason that cultural feminism has been attacked by several later date critics. Their reappraisal constitutes women's passivity as her peacefulness, her sentimentality as her proclivity to nurture, her subjectiveness as her advanced self-awareness. And cultural feminism also attacks lesbian feminists. Though it believes that within the family women can be exploited, still it wants to uphold the tradition of family. It does not go against this basically. And therefore, some studies have suggested that engagement in activities labeled as cultural feminist is linked with a decline in political activity in the women's movement. Black feminism is also a response to the decade of the 1960s. We find that in the 1960s, people were introducing movements for civil rights. In these rights and in these processions, it was thought that women are being sidelined, particularly the black women, and the civil rights movements were more vocal for the equal rights of men across different races. They also thought that the feminist movement of 1960s foregrounded the demands of the white people. So, black women felt that the civil rights movement and the feminist movement have isolated the black women particularly. And because they feel that racism and sexism are intricately linked, this movement has been started. A lot of credit goes to Kimberly Crenshaw's work on intersectionality, which started to be published in and around late 1980s. Now, people also feel, the movement of the black feminists also feel, that the liberation of black women ultimately entails freedom for all people, since it would mean the end of racism, sexism and class oppression. It draws strength from women bonding and spiritual leanings of black matriarchal figures, and sometimes it is also branded as womanism. Major critics of black feminist movement are Toril Mai, bell hooks, Angela Davis, Patricia Hill Collins. Major writers who have given a new lease of life to the black feminist movement are Toni Morrison, Alice Walker, Maya Angelou and Gloria Naylor. Another development in terms of feminist movement is ecofeminism. It unites environment and feminism by looking at the commonality of their demands. It feels that the environment as well as women are exploited in similar nature by men, and therefore, since there are similarities in the senseless exploitation of women and environment, there is a fair case for looking for an eco-feminist movement. They look at the relationships between oppression of women and degradation of nature and talk about racism and other types of social oppression. They believe that there are connections which are strong enough between the female values such as reciprocity, nurturing and cooperation, which are present both among women and in nature and which are exploited equally badly by men. They also feel that the global capitalist and patriarchal system, and in their idea of global, they often use the word north and south, particularly with this idea that the southern people represents the third world countries, because majority of the third world countries or the developing countries are towards the south of the first world. So they say that the global north and south capitalist and patriarchal system is based on triple domination of the southern people, women and nature. And the environmentalist demands are being transferred to the feminist demands, linked together, and this movement has also come up. Now, in these pluralities, we find that gradually we are moving closer to what can be roughly termed as the third wave of feminism. The third wave of feminism, which has been influenced largely by the postmodernist theories and the psychoanalytical theories of Jacques Lacan, Helen Csikszentmihalyi, Julia Kristeva and Lucy Irigaray, have represented an academic shift in terms of its focus. Prior to the third wave of feminism, we find that the idea of movement had been more important, but around 1980s, we find that under the influence of these theorists of postmodernism, there has been a shift in the academic nature of feminist discourses. They have been influenced by Lacan's theory of finding meaning in a network of differences, Helen Csikszentmihalyi's ideas of hierarchies of sexual differences through language and discourse, Julia Kristeva's ideas of plurality and provisionality of textual meanings, and Lucy Irigaray's valorization of feminine discourse. So the third wave of feminism is slightly different from the previous two waves, because the focus is not on the movement. The movement is still there, it has not been isolated absolutely, but the focus has been shifted towards academic tendencies. So we have seen that earlier in our discussion of the postmodernist ideas, that in and around 1980s, feminism as well as other knowledge-based philosophies had started to change direction. And feminism also, instead of being limited to protest and castigation of men, initiated an academic examination of the instability and indeterminacy of gender identity. They scrutinized the cultural conditioning of gender as well as other problematic areas, and suggested that heterosexuality itself could be seen as a kind of panicked closure imposed on a variable of individual choices. So we find that there are some major differences between the first and the second waves of feminist theory and the third wave of the feminist theory. Under the impact of the postmodern philosophy, we find that there has been a blurring of the high and low cultures. There had been a collapse of hierarchies as far as knowledge and opinions were concerned, and there was a renewed emphasis on the local instead of looking at the universal ideas. So, postmodernist approaches encouraged differences and accepted the validity of smaller truths. The local ideas were also given preference. So, these ideas have also had a significant influence on feminist theories, leading gradually towards a construction of the gender theory, the study of masculinities, and the queer theory. So, like postmodernism, we also feel that post-feminism also rejects meta-narratives, and therefore it also opposes the universal picture of women. Earlier it was thought that the feminist movement was dominated by white women, and it is, as a response to it, black feminist movement had also been started. But under the impact of post-modernist theories, feminist movement also started to believe that there are various other differences which cannot be clubbed together as being the experiences of either white women or the black women. So, then post-feminism, which is a term suggested by Thoril May for different configurations of post-modernism and feminism. So, post-feminism started to concentrate on the specific experiences of women belonging to different cultures and societies. And then the difference of race had already been incorporated by the black feminist movement, but the cultural differences were being included only after the introduction of the post-feminist argument. So, they started to jeer at this idea, which was often used as a slogan, that all women are white and all men are black. Post-feminist also does not harp at the image of the strong woman. That was the image which was being presented particularly during the 1960s by the radical feminist. So, they believe that it is perhaps not possible for a woman to be strong at all times, and therefore, they also celebrate the weaknesses as differences as certain stages. So, instead of looking at a monolithic unchangeable picture of a woman as being a strong argumentative woman, they have also celebrated the difference and look at the maternal body. Post-feminism is basically an interdisciplinary dialogue. The earlier feminist traditions had also been interdisciplinary to certain extent, but we find that under the impact of post-modernist philosophy, post-feminist dialogue has become exactly acutely interdisciplinary in its nature. So, a review of women's movement and feminist studies helps us to understand how gradually the concept of gender was being internalized by the feminist critical thought. It initially sensitized us to the fact that the compartmentalization of the two strains, for example, the feminist thought and the masculinities studies, is not feasible as they complement each other and burgeon from mutual strength, retaining all the time their individual differences. So, we would find that feminist philosophers started to feel under the impact of the postmodernist philosophy that any study which focuses only on women is necessarily incomplete. And at the same time, we find that any study which takes up masculinities or gender studies cannot be completed unless and until it engages with the feminist theory. So, while feminist thinking permits gender studies, not all forms of feminism can be thought of as being synonymous of gender studies. The difference would also be there, but feminist studies, the masculinities studies, and the queer studies would always be reinforced by each other, and they cannot be compartmentalized in any way. Gradually, it has led us to an understanding of the term of gender. So far in today's discussions, we have focused on the development of feminist thought in various situations and throughout different ages. But gradually, we would also look at how the concept of gender has come to the foreground. Now, the concept of gender has been used to explore the production of masculine and feminine cells initially in social relationships as well as in literary productions. So, we find that in its early days, the word gender was used for studying the feminist movement as well as masculinities within it. So, the issues related with gendered identities could not be summed up simply as feminist concerns, and to equate them together would also be a theoretical anachronism. So, feminist studies and gender studies are interlinked, but they do not replace each other. So, a study of gender issues necessarily explores into the binary division of people into male and female, and thus it becomes a constricting factor if one hypothesizes about construction of femininity without including construction of masculinity. Gender studies question the definitions of the term woman and man, and consider that gender is an axis of social differentiation as well as inequality, as much as the notions of race, ethnicity, class are concerned. Precepts of gender have led to masculinity and queer studies gradually, focusing on those individual identities which transgress the socially defined boundaries of gender. So, gradually we find that the feminist studies have moved towards a study of masculinities, giving rise to gender, and gradually have started to incorporate a study of transgender in its fold. It is also suggested that gender is an organic construction process which may vacillate with changing societal experiences. Experiences of or exposure to different societal norms may result into changes in gender ideology and association. So far we have discussed how the feminist thought has developed and changed over a certain time. In our discussion henceforth, we would discuss how the cultural focus of feminist movement gradually gives way to an interdisciplinary approach to look at the differences between sex and sexual desires, and then incorporate a study of transgender. So, gradually we would find that the third phase of feminist movement gradually starts incorporating the demands of gender as we understand them today. So, in our next discussion, we would take up how the concept of gender grows further and incorporates other contemporary demands. Thank you.